So tonight I'm talking about living successfully for God. How do we live successfully for God? And I started thinking about this. And tonight it might be a little bit quick, so if you hear me talking about this really, really quick and trying to go really, really fast, it's because I only have Mario informed me that there's only 5 minutes left on this video to be able to record. So about 3 minutes are going to be my sermon, 2 minutes are going to be the altar call. So if you guys are okay with that, just messing with you. But tonight, you know, it might be a little quick. Tonight I was trying to decide, okay, what do I talk about? And it was this that I've been thinking about, and this is what I've been reading on it. And I've been trying to look at Daniel once again. And as I said, you know, right before I started praying, is that we're trying to think of two different names to give my son, and it was Daniel and Joseph. There was a reason why I decided those two names, and I wanted to give him two names that I thought of people in the Bible that held a level of integrity in their life almost like nobody else, basically. There was, when I look at Daniel, I look at Joseph, these guys were men of God. These two men held that level of integrity in their life. And I hope that my son will be able to live up to those names, would be able to live up to the integrity that they had in their lives and in his relationship with God. So as we read tonight, it's going to be out of Daniel chapter 6. Daniel chapter 6, I'm going to try and go through this really, really fast. Daniel chapter 6. It pleased Darius to appoint 100 satraps, not rat traps, but satraps, to rule throughout the kingdom. They probably did have rats too. With 3 administrators over them, of whom was Daniel. The satraps were made accountable to them so that the king might not suffer loss. Now Daniel so distinguished himself among the administrators and the satraps by his exceptional qualities that the king planned to set him over the whole kingdom. At this, the administrators and the satraps tried to find grounds for charges against Daniel in his conduct of governmental affairs, but they were unable to do so. They could find no corruption in him because he was trustworthy and neither corrupt nor negligent. Finally, these men said, "We will never find any basis for charges against this man Daniel unless it has something to do with this law, with the law of his God." So the administrators and satraps went as a group to the king and said, "O King Darius, live forever. The royal administrators, prefects, satraps, advisors, and governors have all agreed that the king should issue an edict and enforce the decree that anyone who prays to any god or man during the next 30 days, except you, O king, shall be thrown into the lion's den. Now, O king, issue the decree and put it in writing so that it cannot be altered in accordance with the law of the Medes and Persians, which cannot be replaced." So King Darius put the decree in writing. Now, when Daniel learned that the decree had been published, he went home and to his upstairs room where the windows opened toward Jerusalem. 3 times a day, he got down on his knees and prayed, giving thanks to his God, just as he had done before. Then these men went as a group and found Daniel praying and spoke to him, or found Daniel praying and asking God for help. So they went to the king and spoke to him about his royal decree. "Did you not publish a decree that during the next 30 days, anyone who prays to any god or man except you, O king, would be thrown in the lion's den?" The king answered, "The decree stands in accordance with the laws of the Medes and Persians, which cannot be repealed." Then they said to the king, "Daniel, who is one of the exiles from Judah, pays no attention to you, O king, or to the decree you put in writing. He still prays 3 times a day." When the king heard this, he was greatly distressed. He was determined to rescue Daniel and made every effort until sundown to save him. Then the man went as a group to the king and said to him, "Remember, O king, that according to the law of the Medes and Persians, no decree or edict that the king issues can be changed." So the king gave the order, and they brought Daniel and threw him into the lion's den. The king said to Daniel, "May your God, whom you serve continually, rescue you." A stone was brought and placed over the mouth of the den, and the king sealed it with his own signet ring and with the rings of his nobles, so that Daniel's situation might not be changed. The king returned to his palace and spent the night without eating and without any entertainment brought to him, and he could not sleep. At the first light of dawn, the king got up and hurried to the lion's den. When he came near the den, he called to Daniel, and in an anguished voice, Daniel's servant of the living God, has your God, whom you serve continually, been able to rescue you from the lions? Daniel answered, O king, live forever. My God sent in his angel and shut the mouths of the lions. They have not hurt me because I was found innocent in his sight. Nor have I ever done anything wrong before you, O king. The king was overjoyed and gave orders to lift Daniel out of the den. And when Daniel was lifted from the den, no wound was found on him because he had trusted in his God. At the king's command, the men who had falsely accused Daniel were brought in and thrown into the lion's den, along with their wives and children. And before they reached the floor of the den, the lions overpowered them and crushed all their bones. Then King Darius wrote to all the peoples, nations, and men of every language throughout the land, May you prosper greatly. I issue a decree that in every part of my kingdom, people must fear and reverence the God of Daniel. For he is the living God, and he endures forever. His kingdom will never be destroyed, will not be destroyed. His dominion will never end. He rescues and he saves. He performs signs and wonders in the heavens and on earth. He has rescued Daniel from the power of the lions. So Daniel prospered during the reign of Darius and the reign of Cyrus the Persian. When I look at this and I'm going through the story and I'm seeing, okay, you know, what is it with Daniel? I mean, he was a man of three things that I looked at in this man. The first thing that I saw in his life was a man of character. And if we go back to verse 3, it says, Now Daniel was so distinguished himself among the administrators and the satraps by his exceptional qualities. For him to have been described as such, one could only think that he was a man who was loyal. He was a man who was submissive to authority. He was a man who... He was submissive, but kept perspective when it came to God and governmental authority. He wouldn't dare to waver in his relationship with God. And you think about what the Bible says. The Bible talks about bad company corrupts good character. So when I looked at him and I was studying him, I said, okay, you know what? Daniel obviously cared about who he was around, who he surrounded himself with. Mind you, he was part of the exiles out over to Babylon, and here he's in this kingdom, he's in this regime where he's having to serve. His name got changed, different things had to happen, but still, even then, his character remained the same of who he was. How many of us, and I think about where we work, whether it's at home, whether it's at work, whether it's at school. What are you like with the people that surround you? Do you surround yourself with people who will corrupt your good character? You know, I think of different people. You know, bad company corrupts good character. Bonnie and Clyde. You know, obviously one of them probably had to tell the other one, hey, let's go rob a bank or let's go do this. Dumb and Dumb. You know, but then again, that one could have been a lost cause. They were both bad. Neither one of them had good thoughts or was smart enough. But you start thinking about, you know, do you surround yourself with people like this? Or are you careful about who you surround yourself with? Daniel was a person who would make sure that his character would not be flawed. He cared about his character. And he said, I don't want there to be anything that could be said about me or my God. He did not want to bring shame to God or himself. To live anything less than the character that he portrayed, to live anything less than what he portrayed, was not living up to what God wanted him to live as. And I started thinking, well, what are those traits? You know, loyalty, you know, respect, are the kind of characteristics that he had. He had those characteristics. You know, I think about recently, and as like I was telling you, I was looking at the story and I was going through it. One of the things that I try and state very clearly with my work is my relationship here at church with God and what I do. I try and state that very clearly. You know, you start thinking about Daniel. Daniel recently just got promoted, and he has new bosses. How many of you guys like it when you guys get changed or you guys have a different boss? What's it like when you have to work under a different boss? I've had the privilege, but I've had to go through quite a bit of bosses. And my current office that I'm at, I went through 3 different managers in roughly 2.5, 3 years, possibly 4 actually. And every one of those is different. But with every one of those, I told them, and I said, I go, look, this is what I do at my church. This is what I'm involved in. And this is the time that I need off when this comes. I make it very clear to them because, you know what, I want them to understand that church and who I am is very important. It's important to me. It's one of my things that I hold dear. So when I go back, I've been off since January 12th, since my son was born. I don't go back till February 20th. My district managers called me while I was on family leave, and they're asking their dad, they're like, Daniel, we need you at this office. Will you move? At first, it wasn't my choice. They were just telling me I was going to move. Then it opened up to be my choice. I weighed the decision. I called pastors. I said, well, look, this is what's going on. You know, I'm praying. Can you, you know, please pray for this. I called my mom. I called my mom in making this, you know, because I know my mom is a mother of prayer. How many of you guys know that mothers pray for their children? And you know what? To me, that's why I hold that relationship with my mom. When I'm going through something, it's, Mom, pray for me, because this is going on. So I made the decision to make that move. So this past Friday, I met the other man. Well, I knew who she was, but I went in just to, you know, show my face and say, hey, you know, how are you doing? You know, I'll be here in a week, about a week away. You know, excited to come over here. They're all excited. My previous employees, and I started thinking about, you know, how did I? And I told her, I said, I just dropped by my other office, and I broke the news to my employees. She's like, really? She's like, how'd it go? And I told her, I said, just about all of them were teared up and had tears, and they were crying. I go, I felt bad. It's hard for me to leave. I go, they're my family. But I started thinking, it's like, what kind of impact did I have? And I hope I had a good enough impact in their life for them to feel the way they felt that I was leaving. So I told her, I said, I go, I will be here. And she told me, well, I just want to let you know, when you come here next week, I'm taking off, I'm going on vacation. All right, bye. So a week after I'm there, she's taking off. I told her, that's fine. You know what, I don't need much time off. But I do need, if our church gets what we're going to get, you know, I'm praying that we get this. If we get this in July, we'll need some time off. I go, and there's probably like another 2 other weeks that I'll need, you know, that our church does stuff. She's like, okay, that's fine. You know, and I look at that, and I hope that by doing so and seeing how people know that I prioritize God, I know that once I put that out there, how many of you guys know that once you put that out there, you say, hey, look, this is what I do at my church, this is where I go, and this is what I do, you have to live up to that. You need to live up to that. That character needs to reflect what you're doing. And so I put that out there because it also keeps me in that position of it's a responsibility I have to reflect that character. Number 2, I saw that Daniel had devotion. He was a man of devotion. Was he devoted to serving in the governmental, you know, position? Yeah. But at the same time, he was a man who would not waver in his devotion to God. If you go to chapter 6, verse 14, it says, he still prays 3 times a day. When the king heard this, he was greatly distressed. He was determined to rescue Daniel and made every effort until sundown to save him. Now that's huge from a king to go out, after he's already made a decree, to actually go out and try and change that, because knowing that they can't change that, he did everything in his power. He said, hey, look, I'm going to do everything I can to help this guy out. Why do you think he's done it? He knew his devotion to his God. He knew his devotion to his God. I don't know how many of you guys believe or know that God, and you have your devotion to God, other people will show their devotion to you. Other people will show their devotion to you, just as his own, the king did here. He did everything he could to be able to try and save him from being killed. Now, you think about, you know, how is our devotion tested? I start thinking about you and I. Are we devoted? What is devotion? Well, number one, you can be devoted in your life, your personal relationship with God. Number one. First and foremost, the most important thing is your personal relationship with God. Daniel was so devoted that he would pray 3 times a day. Puts us to shame, probably. Most of us, more than likely, are lucky enough to actually go once a day. Probably. But this was a man of devotion. He cared about his relationship with God. I mean, you think about that. You know, what does that say about him? It didn't matter to him, you know, what was going on around him. It didn't matter to him that he was threatened by the threat of death. To many of us, it's like, you know, what's the thing that holds us up? Even the threat of death did not hold him back from his devotion to God. What is it that holds us up from our devotion to God, whether it be in our personal relationship or here at the church, is the other devotion that we can show towards God. What is it that holds us back? And I started thinking to myself, when I look at this, don't think I'm just preaching to you, I'm preaching to myself here. What is it that holds my devotion to God, either my personal relationship with him or my service here? The two most important things in my life. My most important thing in my life is that relationship with God. And I had to look at that and I said, it's not all that it's cracked up to be. It's not where it should be. I had to examine my heart and I said, I've been off for these last 5 weeks. Where was I? You know, did I show that devotion? Or was there the threat of laziness? Was there the threat of television? Was there the threat of PlayStation? It was hard. And so it started reminding me and said, you know, Daniel, you need to start separating more time from him. So I actually enjoyed it. I started thinking of, you know, what is it that I can do? The other day I told my wife, I said, baby, are you proud of me? She's like, why? I go, what do you notice? I can't remember what you said. What did you say? You said something else. It wasn't it. I'm trying to remember what it was. You said something. It was completely something else. And I'm like, well, yeah, I go back to. I go, well, what else? I go, did you notice it? And she's like, well, what? I go, I haven't turned on the TV not once. And it was like 4 o'clock in the afternoon. 5 o'clock in the afternoon. And even then, I was just like, and I was like, you know what? I'm taking this time off. I'm taking this time off one bond with my child. I'm taking this time off. It's probably been the greatest time to bond with Ariana. When she was born, I took probably 2.5 weeks. I didn't do that. Part of being devoted to your relationship with God is also loving your family and being there for them. She asked me, on Friday we went out for my birthday, and we went by the place where I'm moving from, and my boss asked me, she goes, so what are you guys going to do? My other employee asked me, what are you guys doing tonight? I'm like, why nothing? And he's like, really? I go, no. And then she's like, yeah, she goes, he's boring. I go, whatever. And she's like, and he goes, no, he goes, I understand him. He goes, he's just like me. He doesn't care, because as long as, you know, he doesn't have to do anything and he relaxes and he rests. I go, exactly. That's the thing that is most important to me. I go, if all I can do is just be with my wife, be with my daughter, be with my son all day long, that's all that matters to me. And at the end of the day, she asked me, so would, you know, how's the day today? And I go, it was probably exactly everything that I wanted. I go, we were busy. I go, I was kind of sorry. You know, we had to go here and there. I go, but the most important thing is that I did it with you guys. you know, I loved it. You know, it was fun. And I told her, I said, I go, it's just coming home and just being home. It's the most important thing to me. You know, when you're devoted to God, like I said, when you are devoted to God, others will show their devotion to you. Number three, I looked at the integrity of Daniel, the integrity of no matter what comes, I'm still going to serve God. No matter what the thing is that comes and tries to stop me, I'm still going to serve God. You look at Titus 1:16, and I think about the integrity that he has, and I start wondering, you know, does Titus 1:16 reflect maybe the way we are sometimes? Titus 1:16 says, they claim to know God, but by their actions they deny him. They're detestable, disobedient, and unfit for doing anything good. I think about it, you know, what is integrity? Integrity is, what do you do? What is it that you do and I do when nobody's around? What is the one thing that you do when you know you have to make a decision? Maybe you don't consult with anybody because you don't want to tell anybody what your thoughts are. And it's that inside your mind of, you know, what are you going to do? Are you going to do what's right? Or are we going to do what's wrong? You know, do we hold that standard of, I can't waver in this? You know, is our integrity so that people will speak of us like King Darius did? When I look at what King Darius spoke of Daniel, I mean, you know, is it so that we can actually say what Daniel said? And he said, Daniel answered in verse 21, he said, O king, live forever. My God sent his angel, and he shut the mouth of lions. They have not hurt me, because I was found innocent in his sight. Nor have I ever done any wrong before you, O king. Can you and I say that about the relationships that we carry with other people? Can you and I say that about the relationship that we have with God? I mean, that's something. Be able to actually say those words. I was found innocent with no fault. You know, I think about these three things. I think, you know, living successfully for God. You know, we talk about in iron sharpens iron and things that we do. Are we successful? Are we not? Well, there's three things here that I feel that are really, really important to our walk with God. There's three things here that I feel are really, really important to the success of our walk with God, number one. Number two, to the success of our church. If we live these values, how much more will other people want to live those values? If we exemplify what he wants us to be like, how much more will other people want to do that? I go back to my thought of my employees that I'm leaving behind, and I think of them, and I ask myself, did I make a lasting impact? Not just an impression. Because the impression comes and goes. They say the first impression matters most. Well, impressions, like I said, come and go. But an impact can last a lifetime. When I'm gone, will they be calling me and saying, you know, hey, when's Puppet Master again? Will they be calling me and saying, you know, hey, what are you guys doing? Or how's everything going with you? I feel bad because one of the things that they said is that Christine told me, she goes, damn, she goes, I feel so bad. I said, why? She goes, the remark that they made, she goes, they said that they were counting down the days until you came back. And that floored me. I felt bad. But at the same time, I told them, I said, you guys are going, don't hold yourself back. You know, one thing is, you know, I believe, you know, we have to be successful in our life for God. But at the same time, we have to care so much for others that we care about their success too. We care about whether they're successful in life or not. And the one thing I told my employees is that do not hold yourself back. I go, move on, move up. Do what you need to do to move up. Do what's right. So in conclusion, I want to close tonight. I hope everybody here is, you know, open to what's been talked about and what's been said. Bow your head. Close your eyes. I want you to reflect on your heart. Could you and I live up to his character, to the devotion that Daniel showed? Could you and I live up to the integrity that Daniel showed? Or are there areas in our life that we're lacking in? And as I said earlier, I'm not preaching just to you. I'm preaching to myself. Are there areas in your life that you feel, God, I know that I'm not devoted to you. God, I know I'm not devoted to you as much as you are to me. Because whether we're right or whether we're wrong, God's faithfulness does not change. God's love for us does not change. God's provision, he comes through when you least expect it and you say, I was not worthy of this. And I think about